Welcome to the closing lecture of the course Business Process Intelligence. I hope you enjoyed the previous lectures. In this lecture, we are going to look back on all the things that we have seen. So we have been closely following the process mining book. At the end of every lecture, I would show exactly, let's say, the chapters that we have covered. But if you want to read more, there is also, let's say, much more information in the book that I did not cover. Of course, I also detailed a few things a bit further than I indicated in the book. What one should also note is that the chapter on process mining software is, of course, changing basically every year. I'm trying to make an update of the book to also, let's say, refresh that part. So what we will do in this closing lecture is we will look at the last two chapters, come to a conclusion, and make the link to cartography and navigation. Then I make a summary and provide some pointers if you would like to get into more detail. So let's start with the link to cartography and navigation. So you can think of process models as maps. And of course, we have lots of experience in making maps. The first geographical maps date back to a long time before. And process mining models can be seen as such. But when you compare them, you immediately get some insights that are useful. So here you see a map of the center of Moscow, where I spent a bit of time. And if you look at such a map, that is the notion of abstraction. So we leave out roads that are insignificant. We do not see all the roads. It's the same as if we would look in Google Maps and would look at Germany. We only see the highways. Only if we zoom in, we will see smaller roads. There's aggregation. So different streets are aggregated into suburbs or cities. We have size and color. So everybody will understand that the road that I'm now pointing at is actually, let me do that, the road that I'm pointing at is a highway. And this is a big road and the gray ones are small roads. So we immediately see what things mean, and where something is positioned has a clear meaning, namely a geographic meaning that is where the road is. If you look at process models, this is not the case. First of all, of course, we have these sliders, but if we look at everything, we basically, there is no notion of abstraction. If we are using a notion of abstraction, it will be very coarse, so we use a slider, but we simply start dropping activities that are infrequent. So there is some form of abstraction, but it is very, very limited. Aggregation is typically missing in most of the process mining tools. If we look at maps, they typically look like this. If we draw a BPMN model or a PetriNet, the size and color have no semantics. Also, the layout has no semantic. So there is a graph layout algorithm that is often even not deterministic. So each time you produce the same model, it may show something different. In any case, it has no meaning. So can we see what matters most in process models? And of course, you've seen several process mining tools that overlay process models with frequency and time information. But if we just use BPMN as a modeling notation, it typically looks like this. We cannot see frequency. We cannot see what is important. We cannot see what is costly. We cannot see how many resources are involved, etc., etc. So we cannot see these things. But if we look at the map, we can immediately see that. And we can learn from that. And if you look at process mining tools, you can see that some of these ideas have moved into the drawing of process models. What is important to realize is that there is no such thing as the map. Here we are looking again at the center of Moscow. So this is a map, but we cannot say this is now the map or the best map. You can generate different maps depending on your usage. And there is no way that you can say that one map is better than another one. For example, I'm now zooming in to this part, and now I see roads that I could not see before, but also roads have disappeared. So this is illustrating that there is no such thing as the map. I can also have this view. is this view now better than this view? It depends on what I would like to do with it. We are often looking for, let's say, mathematical certainty, what is the best process model, but it's a bit as what I'm showing here, it depends on how you're going to use process models, what is useful. For example, if you go by subway, a map like this is pretty useless, but a map like this is very valuable. So here we see the entire Moscow. Please note that traveling from one end to the other end typically takes more than an hour. So we are covering a huge geographic area, and it all fits on a single page. So this is very powerful. But of course, where the nodes are exactly somehow corresponds to where the real physical position is, but not exactly. So this map has been made, let's say, more regular than it would normally work, which would be a problem if we would be using something else than the subway, if we would go by bicycle. For example, the circle is of course not a perfect circle, but because we are underground, it doesn't matter. So maps depend on how you use them. For example, here you see a bicycle map, and of course a bicycle map looks completely different as the map to use the metro or trains or something like that. So map is a view on reality, it's an abstraction, it is not the reality itself, and what is a good map depends on the use. And the same, of course, applies to process models. So process models provide a view on data. If you would normally look at the data, you would not see any structure, but through process models, you can see the structures that you're interested in, if you pick the right map. So there may be many different views on the same reality. We also talked about object-centric process mining, where you don't fix a single case identifier, but any event can refer to any number of objects. And then it becomes very flexible with this, based on the same event data, we can show many different views from the viewpoint of multiple types of objects or just one type of object, zooming in, zooming out, etc., etc. What's also important is that process models that are static are not very useful, right? They are typically put into a drawer and nobody will look at them. Process models become extremely valuable if they are used by machines, for example, to generate predictions or to trigger actions, or they become useful if they are constantly extended with additional information which is relevant for people. Just look, if you're looking in the morning at the weather forecast, you see a map. If that map would always be the same, you would not watch the weather forecast. You watch the weather forecast, because on that map, it is projected what the temperatures are going to be, etc., etc. And this is exactly the same with process models. So here again, I'm showing the center of Moscow, and now highlighted in red are the streets where at that particular point in time, there was a traffic jam. So we can see where the traffic is flowing smoothly, that's green, where it's red, there is a congestion. So we can map onto such a map traffic jams, but for example, if we would look at an application where we are an app to look at selling houses or something like that, it would map completely different information. So we enrich these maps with things like crime rates, energy prices, energy usage, average income, etc., etc. And by projecting such information on maps, it becomes very, very useful. If we look at process models, the obvious use cases are to project bottlenecks and deviations on top of that, or costs. Yeah, so costs is often obtained by simply multiplying the frequency times the standard cost, but sometimes there is additional information here. So as I've been telling in the last couple of lectures, we are always interested in compliance and performance diagnostics, and we want to project such diagnostics on the process models. Of course, I'm not showing you anything new if I'm showing diagrams like this. So here we see the inductive miner applied to a particular synthetic data set. So we can see exactly the frequencies. We can play with the sliders very much like we could zoom in and zoom out in Google Maps. We also saw Disco with very much the same ideas, but then of course only a directly follows graph. And in all of these tools, one can also do an animation. So one can have the actual cases flowing through the process model, providing a lot of information. Many of these ideas are not so new. This is a very famous example in the field of, let's say, visualization, visual analytics, etc. It's a map that is already 300 years old that is showing, let's say, on the movement of Napoleon's army to Moscow, for example, how many soldiers there were, and in black you see that when the soldiers are retreating, and that in the end, let's say, very few soldiers survived. It is showing much more information. For example, you see the temperature at the bottom, and this is this overlaying of a map with information, very much as we see in the field of process mining. Next to cartography, I would also like to link it to navigation. Yeah, so these process models can also be used for navigational purposes. Let us take a look at the navigation device. So a navigation device is providing a recommendation. We said that we want to go to a certain address, and the navigation says system says that we need to turn in within 70 meters. It makes a prediction when we arrive at the location, and if I'm driving faster than 80 kilometers per hour, the device starts making funny noises. So this is showing that maps are combined with the actual real-time behavior to generate recommendations, predictions, and to provide warnings if something non-compliant is happening. So this is the connection between process models and operational support. And operational support can build on all the incredible advances that happened in the field of machine learning in the last two decades. So if we map this to, if we make this link, then we are interested in information systems that are driven by such maps, that are not forcing us to do certain things, because a well-known example are things like order to cash and purchase to pay. If you would make a workflow model not knowing the actual data, you would probably have a model that is very simple. If you would force people to work exactly the way that the model would say, basically very few of your customers would fit into that model. So on the one hand, one needs to guide. On the other hand, one needs to be flexible. And while being flexible, you still want to record event data to, in hindsight, look in hindsight analyze why were there certain performance problems, why were there certain compliance problems. So today's information systems cannot do this, but the combination of process mining with modern forms of automation, workflows that are automatically triggered by diagnostics from process mining, can do something that functions a bit like what I just sketched. So this was the last chapter in the book, making the connection between process mining and cartography and navigation. And now I would like to briefly summarize what we have seen throughout the course. Process mining is the missing link between data science and process science. I hope that has become very, very clear. Mainstream data science techniques and mainstream process science techniques tended to ignore, let's say, the combination of both, that you need both processes and data. And only in recent years, process mining has provided, let's say, the connection between these two areas. It sounds very obvious, but for a long time, this was not possible and not done. If you use process mining, you can show what is really going on. You can show where the bottlenecks are, and you can show where the deviations are. With respect to the happy path with respect to a normative model, whatever we take as input. What we've also seen, and what I've stressed throughout the different lectures, is that many processes follow a so-called Pareto distribution, at least if you look at it in the right way. So what you see here is you see a purchase-to-pay process with over 67,000 cases, and these 67,000 cases generate almost 7,000 variants. So 7,000 unique ways of executing this process, ignoring time, data, resources, just looking at the ordering of activities. And this spaghetti model shows that there is a huge potential to improve such processes, because not all of these 7,000 variants are desirable. And the idea is to find the variants that you would like to avoid to happen, and to reroute them to variants that have shown, based on the evidence, that they lead to good outcomes. So this is the goal. And to approach this, you can always, let's say, simplify these models. For example, you can focus on the variants that explain 80% of the cases. And of course, it's much better, but that's a bit outside of the scope of what I'm telling now. It's much better to first select, let's say, a limited number of activities, because one would never like to look at a model with dozens or hundreds of different activities. As a rule of thumb, try to look at process models with, let's say, up to 20 different activities. Looking at more activities at the same time is not so meaningful. But assuming that is all okay, then here we are looking at a model that describes 80% of the cases. But interestingly, in this data set, 80% of the cases is described by only 300 of the 7,000 variants. So with a bit over 4% of all the variants, we are able to describe 80% of the cases. So these are the highways in our process model. I can go even further. I can look at the top 10 variants. So now we are covering around 0.1%. So we are covering just a very tiny fraction of all the variants, just 10 out of 7,000. And these 10 out of 7,000 are describing 35% of all the cases. And that gives a feel for real life data and how you can always make things simpler and how you can always get insights out of this. This picture has been shown in many lectures as a kind of overview map to see where we are. And to summarize the course, I will walk again through this. So what we have just seen is that we need to extract event data, and event data may reveal processes that have lots of variations. What you typically see is that if people start doing process mining for the first time, they are spending up to 80% of just data extraction and data transformation. Also, process mining reveals often data quality problems that were always there, but nobody saw them. Process mining will make that very visible. For example, if people are swapping day and month information, then if you apply process mining, you will immediately see that. Even if you have extracted the data, there are still many design choices. For example, the choice of case identifier. If you're using object-centric process mining, you can avoid that. You don't have to do that. But if you use normal process mining tools, you need to pick a case identifier. And given the same process, there may be multiple candidate case identifiers. There may also be multiple scopes. So data extraction is crucial, right? Because you know the saying, garbage in, garbage out. So one should be very careful about that. Then once you have the event data, it is relatively straightforward. So you can push on a button and you immediately generate a process model. There are the directly follows graphs that you typically see as the opening screen in commercial process mining tools. Directly follows graphs are scalable and very easy, but as I pointed out in my lectures, one should be very careful about with them when you're filtering. because that may lead to unexpected results. What you also see is that if activities are not happening in a fixed order, and in most basic processes that is the case, it will immediately introduce loops, even if activities are never executed in a loop. They are never executed multiple times. You will still see these loops because the model has to allow for all the different orders. Therefore, we spend a lot of time on more advanced discovery techniques. We have started with the alpha algorithm, which is a very important algorithm to understand the challenges of process discovery, if you would like to discover concurrency. It doesn't work very well on real data. It is also not intended to do so. However, it's very important from a didactical point of view to understand the alpha algorithm. After the alpha algorithm, we looked at more practical approaches, for example, the heuristic miner and the inductive mining technique that I'm often using when showing you a model. So using these more advanced discovery techniques, you may avoid spaghetti diagrams and you get higher level models, for example, expressed in BPMN, PetriNets, UML activity diagrams, UML state charts, etc. Then there is the step of once you have the model and you have the data, you can combine them to do both conformance checking and performance analysis. The input of conformance checking is event data and a process model, and you highlight both in the event data and the process model where there is agreement and where there is disagreement. And when you see a frequent deviation, you can use further techniques to see what these deviations have in common. The same applies to performance analysis. So you, by replaying the event data on top of the models, you will see where the bottlenecks are. And again, you can try to explain what is causing these bottlenecks. And so diagnosis is always playing a role there. If you have these models that are also enriched with information about bottlenecks, potentially also about the resource being used, etc., etc., you can use these models to do predictive process mining, and that you use the model in a forward-looking manner, or you can use it to do comparative process mining. In comparative process mining, you're comparing, for example, the same process in different months. And so there is a bottleneck in March that was not there in February, and you would like to understand why. Or you have two offices, one in Aachen, one in Munich, and you would like to understand why in one office certain things work well and they do not work well in another office. So that's comparative process mining, and that is, let's say, the forward-looking form of process mining, doing predictive process mining. That's, of course, very much related to the topic of operational support. Operational support is not just related to prediction. One would like to turn the findings and the data into actions. So how can that be done? Well, often just by showing process mining results, you already create awareness. And even if you don't change any of the systems, just by showing the results, the behavior of people may already change. So people may have done things that were non-optimal in the past, and you can, by just showing the results, the behavior changes because they see, well, if we do things in this and this way, we are generating a lot of work for other people, or we are creating incredible waiting times for customers. So it's awareness. Then there is the implementation of changes, for example, changing the process, changing the structure of an organization, changing the information system. And of course, to turn data into actions, you often also want to explore alternatives. And there are things like simulation, discrete event simulation, based on a model learned using process mining, is used. Many people today talk about a digital twin, and you can think of a digital twin as a complete model covering all the different perspectives, learn from event data, and you let this digital twin run concurrent to the real process, and you can use the digital twin to explore, let's say, the effects of certain changes that you would like to make. There's also, of course, also a link to automation. In the early days, process mining would actually be called workflow mining, having already these things in mind. So process mining results can be used to automate processes better. For example, if there are certain problems, you can automatically trigger workflows that try to address that problem. Process mining can also be used to identify repetitive work done by people. And then we are in the world of, let's say, robotic process automation, where the first step in robotic process automation is to decide what is the repetitive work currently done by people that you would like to be done by a software robot. And of course, process mining is one of the key technologies to decide that. We've seen this diagram before, so here I'm sorting again process variants based on their frequency. And if we look at process variants which are extremely frequent, they typically have already been automated using traditional automation. If we look at process variants which are infrequent, which are, let's say, one of a kind, they typically require human involvement because the human is able to do things, for example, transfer learning in a much better way than algorithms can do, especially when being confronted with a new situation. RPA is the segment in the middle where traditional automation is too expensive, but people are still doing repetitive work. And that repetitive work is taken over by a software robot. So this is linking RPA to process mining, but of course this is just one of many possible use cases of process mining. Currently there are over 35 process mining vendors, and we've seen several of them. Some of them are really large. So if you look at the valuation of a company like Celonis, but also a company like UiPath, that is amazing. What you also see is that there is, let's say, some convergence in the market. So for example, earlier this year, IBM bought MyInvenio and SAP bought Signavio. And now process mining is, for example, an integral part of a system like SAP. Many tools, and these tools have all different capabilities, and the process mining will increasingly become a commodity integrated in a lot of other tools. There are many organizations already using process mining. I think it's fair to say that in the north of Europe, most of the larger organizations are using process mining for some of their processes. But we are just at the beginning. So process mining still is invisible for many of the smaller companies. And also within the larger companies, it is typically applied just in a limited number of areas, while it could be applied in many more areas. So it's easy to start with process mining and to analyze things like purchase to pay and order to cash. But what is very important is that organizations are also using it to analyze their core processes. So for example, BMW, the core use case is not purchase to pay and order to cash, but the core use case is of course production, because that is where they need to excel. So I hope that this gives again an overview of the things that have been discussed. If you would like to learn more, there are by now several process mining books available. You see some of them here. Of course, we have been walking through the let's say, process mining Bible, that is describing all the theory, let's say, also in a lot of detail, that you very clearly understand the concepts. But for example, there are also books dedicated to healthcare, dedicated to specific process mining tasks like conformance checking. And there is also this book edited by Lars Rankemeyer, which describes many case studies in many of the, let's say, successful organizations like BMW, Siemens, and many other companies that have applied process mining and share their experiences. So you can read much more. If you look at pointers to papers and data sets, then here are some starting points, just a few of many. So you can go to my homepage. There you will find many papers that you can read without being behind the paywall of some publisher. There is the website processmining.org, which is in the process of being updated, showing basically many, many different pointers, helping people that are new to the topic to find their way. There is the IEEE Task Force on Process Mining, which is, for example, also releasing a newsletter. If you are interested in process mining, you're welcome to join the task force. It's very simple. You can just fill out a web form if you go to this page, and you can join the task force, and then you will also get information about events that are being organized. You will also get a newsletter, etc., etc. There is the annual International Conference on Process Mining, the ICPM conference. You can look at DLBP, where you find many different papers. As a, for example, you can go to my page, and from there you can also look at that is linked to many of my co-authors that published many, many papers in this field. If you would like to look at data sets on a website like processmining.org, on a website like the Task Force on Process Mining, there are already these data sets. But here there are also, let's say, many data sets that all have a DOI, and that means that they can be referenced, having a link that is stable, and anybody in the world can download and use them. We are very interested in collaborating. If you are a student, let's say in the field of process mining, I hope that that you got some more inspiration, that you got some more ideas on interesting and challenging thesis projects that you did. If you are, let's say, a process mining end user or a potential process mining end user, I hope I gave you, let's say, pointers to where to get the information. If you have studied this information and are interested in collaboration, we are open and welcome to that. Of course, we would also like to continue being in touch with, let's say, lots of the process mining experts to hear about their experiences, etc. We're also very much interested in joint projects. So many research projects require, let's say, both an academic and an industry partner. So if you're working in industry, you have a good understanding of process mining and you are interested in a project, you know where to contact us. Here you can see some pointers. And I hope you will turn it to use what I've talked about.